today's episode we will see the whole scenario. In today's episode, we discuss or we look at empathy. We measure by asking ourselves, what is empathy? Is empathy important in children? Is it something we may be interested as parents, as caregivers, or even as educators to nurture in children? Because our interest or our intention is to nurture the whole child, to grow a child in all aspects of their development. So we start by asking ourselves, what is empathy? The definition of empathy, of course, is no different when it applies to children from what it is when they are regarding to others. It cuts across all ways of empathy. So what is empathy? So generally speaking, empathy is as simply defined as just having that ability to walk in somebody's shoes, to feel what they feel, and process what they could be going through, and at a more advanced stage, try and help them feel better. So empathy is an aspect, we can look at it, in this case, an aspect of emotional development. So we may ask ourselves again, is empathy a universal response to suffering or the feelings of others? Definitely no, because we don't all react or respond the same to other people's situations, to other people's feelings, and generally, other people's thoughts. So we are saying it is not universal, and so we cannot expect children or even others to respond the same way to certain situations or certain conditions or things that other people could be going through. So simply defined, empathy is the ability to feel other people's feelings, or even to, and after feeling, do you try to make it better for them? Do you, are you able to process what it is that someone could be going through and offer or try to make them feel better? Are you concerned about what your actions or statements could make other people feel? Are you careful to make other people, not feel bad about their situations? You know? So generally, empathy is that ability to connect, to feel and to respond to other people's feelings. So, in today's episode, we look at generally what empathy is to every other person, but once again, like I said, our interest in children. Is it something we may want to develop in children in our endeavor or in our efforts to build or to nurture our children in eternity or holistically? So we look at types of empathy, we talk about affective empathy, just as it comes from the word affect, the affective domain, the ability to feel and to show concern. Just that, you know, when you see someone looking sad, just asking them, are you really okay? Is everything okay? That is affective empathy. Then we have somatic empathy. Somatic, from the word somatic, has to do with physical. You know, there are people who, when they see others, you know, they see a situation that is emotionally charged, they react physically. Like if you see a risky accident, maybe you start getting a headache, you know. When someone says something mean or embarrassing to another person, you blush. It's not said to you, but you find yourself blushing. It's like you're reacting on behalf of another person, and you're doing so physically. So, simply defined, that is somatic empathy. Then we have cognitive empathy. When you can think, is that, you know, someone hasn't told you exactly what they feel about a situation, But judging by how they are behaving, you can almost think, you know, if someone, if you are in a gathering or in a meeting and someone steps aside and sits alone in some corner, they have not said anything, they have not told you anything, you ask them, is everything okay? They say, oh, yeah, I'm good, I'm full. But when you're looking at them, you're thinking, could we have said something that offended that person? Could they be thinking that maybe it won't be there here? Would she be thinking that that was a targeted remark? So that ability, we call it cognitive empathy. So those are simple definitions. We now know what empathy is. We now know some three types of empathy. There could be more, but I just looked at those three for now. Now I need to ask, do you think empathy is an important trait, even as we nurture children? Is it something we may be interested in? Do we care to ask ourselves, if we are raising children, who can feel other people's pain or concern, and who can even try to make it better for other people? Because I believe generation after generation, we always try to make it better for the next generation. So if we have lived across a generation in life where people didn't care so much, I'm certain that is not what we would like to pass our children. So in our effort to raise a holistic child, we definitely would be interested in trying to create or trying to nurture empathy. And interestingly, just like any other domain of development, empathy also is developed right away from early childhood, right away from infancy. Just the same way you would need to build your child's cognition. Just the same way you need to feed your child for them to grow up well, to gain weight appropriately, to grow tall, generally just to grow and to develop well, right from when they are small. And that is why you are interested in the kind of food you're giving them. That's why you're interested in taking them for checkups, so that the clinicians may see if the children are growing up well within the recommended, you know, and they are meeting the recommended milestones at the appropriate age. In the same way, you may be interested, actually you should be interested in seeing to it that your child is growing with empathy, right from the moment. And, you know, we may be asking ourselves, so how, you already told us that when you want to take children away from the screen, we give them other activities that we take their time. So how do we deal with empathy? Simple. Like again, most other skills that a child will learn in life, most of them, they learn from modeling. Same case with empathy, right from infancy. When you're living one cry for attention, and you're there maybe chatting with your friends or busy calling your phone, or just generally engaged in some activity in the house, do you ignore them? Do you say, no one ever died of crying? Or do you come out and check on them, reassure them, tell them, mommy is here, don't worry, I'm here, they're not alone, you know, just that reassurance. Or are they left to cry themselves to sleep? As simple as that. Because when you show empathy, when you show that concern, you are actually telling the child indirectly, one is not a very good thing. You know, as much as another, you may be thinking otherwise, when your child sees that attention, when they see you coming to check on them after letting out that cry, that maybe most of the times may not mean so much to you, you are indirectly telling them, I care. So, we keep using this phrase, children learn by what they see more than what they hear. So you are telling an infant, mommy is here, don't worry. Did you think I left you alone? No, you're telling them all that. They may not quite, you know, make meaning out of it because their brains are still developing. But But as you're doing that, as you're telling them that, they are seeing the action. And the fact that you left what you are doing and came to attend to me is a statement that someone cares. So when you grow up seeing care, when you grow up seeing attention, when you grow up seeing response, not necessarily having your all demands being given into, but that response, whether you're being told not now, whether you're being told, wait a little, there's something I'm attending to, I will pick you up. But at least someone is responding to you. That's already building empathy. Interestingly, other than, as opposed to intelligence and physical attractiveness, which we can simply say that majorly depends on genetics, empathy is not something we inherit. Empathy. You know, there are those things like how you look, how you appear, your physique and everything. Most of the time, it will be largely. There could be a small percentage of other determinants, but largely that one is determined by genetics. But for empathy, you learn. It's something, it's a skill that a child learns. So we may ask ourselves, why empathy? Why do we need to get interested in empathy, especially in that? It's important because empathy is a skill whose value is multifold. You know, if a child has developed empathy, it's easier for that child to do well in school. Again, children with empathy do better. Or function better in social situations. And as for teens and adolescents, those who display or who show empathy are more likely to be, they are more likely to be considered as leaders by their peers. And it's for obvious reasons. I feel like you feel me. That is why most of the time, as parents, we are left there by, not left there, quote unquote, by our teens. They go to share and confide a lot of their issues with their peers. Because they feel like, you feel me, I understand, you understand me, you know? Because we don't seem to feel them at their level. You know, sometimes you may feel, but you are feeling as others, and you are already foreseeing it because we have been there. But if a team constant and keeps displaying, if a team displays empathy, their peers will looking up to them, they consider them as if they can go to, as if they can reach out when they are faced with a tough situation. So now I hope we all know why empathy is important for children and why we are taking all this time to discuss about empathy in children. So briefly, having said that empathy is not something that we may 100% pass on to our children, or our children may inherit from us, it's something they would rather teach or facilitate them to acquire. How do we do this? As we have said before, modeling. How do you, as a caregiver and as a parent? And for this particular skill, I need to mention it. To mention the fact that, in as much as for the other things I've been talking about, caregivers, talking about teachers, and talking about parents, almost concurrently. And this is very intentional because I believe all these are key players in the nurturing a child, especially in places of working parents. We can never talk about childcare without referring to caregivers. And as children grow, we cannot talk about childcare, not referring to teachers, but empathy, considering it's a skill that children start acquiring right from infancy. We need to realize that the primary caregiver, a lot of responsibility squarely lies on the primary caregiver. In most cases, it is the parent, or in some cases, the caregiver may be a relative or just a nanny. But you try, I'm saying that empathy is a skill that is fast acquired control. So as a parent, how are you, how do you respond to your child? For example, when your child is throwing tantrums, when your child is cranky, when your child is, you know, is misbehaving, what again? How do you respond? Because how you respond is actually training them indirectly. If a child is throwing tantrums, rolling down because maybe they are demanding for a certain story, or they're asking for more screen time, how do you respond? Your response communicates to them. You can decide to bowl at them, you know, give them those long lectures which they may hardly understand. You can easily also quietly sit them down and tell them, I understand. You may have wanted to sit a little longer here and watch what it is that you are watching, but see, we can't sit all day long on screen because we have other things to do, and because again, all that light is not free, depending on how old your child is. One older child, you may tell them, you know, we have tasks, home chores to do, we have homework to do, we have house chores to do, and just generally, all that screen time is not too good for you. You know, your team is sulking because they wanted to go for a sleepover at their friends. You know, how do you respond to that expression of their emotions? Their feelings disappointed. They may not quite understand why you just have to flatly say no. So how do you respond? You know, do you ignore them and just say that, ah, they'll start and eventually they'll come around. Or do you call them and sit them down quietly and tell them, hey, I understand that you really, really want to go to your friend's house. And I did approve that because of the following reasons. I know this doesn't feel very good to you, but clearly that is a family, this is what we stand for, these are our family values. We do not ascribe to sleepovers. And I'm hoping that whenever you say you don't agree to something, you're already aware of that. Because in our previous episode, we have talked about communicating family values to your children. Let them know what to expect, what not to expect, because this again reduces emotionally charged moments where there's a lot of tension and basically, how you respond to your child's emotions or emotional displays is a way of training them how to show empathy. You know, for the longest time, or even just growing up, when a boy would fall down, you know, the common statement would be, get up, you're a man, that's the step up. But when a girl falls down, you know, it would be common practice to pick up the girl and tell him also, you know, really sorry to get hurt. What really for the to the boy? You get up, you're a man, men don't cry. So I don't know, parents. A caregiver, this what I think do to the teacher. We can leave this to discussion for a later date, but I'm trying to say how you communicate and how you respond to your child's emotion will either help them develop empathy or, you know, it has been passed over the across generations that it's not crying, why you crying? So what is happening? Do we get men expressing their emotion? I think that discussion can be shared for a later date. So, another way of helping children learn from something is modeling. How do you, as a caregiver, as a mother to myself, like, how do you respond to other people's feelings? You know, if someone plays, even someone that may could be walking the road with your child, and you see a beggar, for instance. I use that example because I've gone through that quite numerous times with my children. A lot of times I've had to, you know, get out of my comfort and have to attend to them, and this These are moments of pride, even for me as a teacher, as a parent, you know, when you see children feeling for other people, it really says so much. So when you find someone seated, someone looking miserable, and you know, blinking, and you just pass them. And most of the time, parents, they bear with us. We have our children pulling us, and because maybe we are reasoning like others, we know the world is full of people who sometimes are not honest, they could become us, and so we just want to quickly move past them. And you have a little one pulling and telling, mommy, girl, see this, you don't have food. You know, I found myself in such a lot of times. There are times I've had to pull out a lot of bread from my shopping basket because my children wouldn't let me go past that person. So how do you respond? You know, you may not believe in the need of that person at that moment because in another, there's something you know that your child doesn't, may not know. But for the purposes of teaching your child empathy, it doesn't cost much. If your child tells you, not that person is need. And if you had shop, maybe you had picked, bought a bunch of bananas. Pick one banana and pass it across. So you are growing. Your child has already shown a response, that has already shown an indication that they are developing empathy, a concern for other people's situations. So when you do that, you are reinforcing it. Are you good? Do you show concern when someone is in problems, or do you just say, ah, they will deal, you know? If a child is growing up here, ah, they will deal, that's their problem, not my problem. How we are fighting? What are you communicating? So if you are modeling empathy, definitely children will pick it up. They will pick it up. Another way as a parent or as a caregiver or as a teacher that you could help children learn empathy is through creating hypothetical situations where, you know, if you sit your child down and you tell them, what would you feel if someone, for example, in school, you carry your water bottle, if someone picks your water and starts on it into it, into your water, what would you feel? Sometimes you hear things like, oh, that is so gross, I would be so disgusted, that is so mean, that would be so bad, I would feel really bad. So you can use that response from your child to tell them, yeah, this is what you would feel when someone does bad things to them. So in essence, you tell them, you need to be careful how you treat other people. What would you feel when someone, if someone picks your favorite toy, for example? You just be like, I would feel so bad, I would grab it from them, you know, do all these things. So you're telling them, if that is what you would feel, then you don't do it to someone else. So in essence, during this exchange, you're teaching them, you're creating situations that may not be there, or may never happen, or may happen, and helping your children realize that people are justified to feel bad. And people are distinct, they are different from them. It's the same way your child will feel bad if someone picks or grab their feeling to it from them. It's the same way that this other person will feel. And this can cut across all things, you know, like you're walking across the street and someone slaps at your back. And you'll be like, I would feel so, so bad. I would feel so violated. You know, things have their executive functions pretty developed, so, or at least more developed. So they may have the vocabulary to spread their feelings. But as they say that, then you can actually now use that emotion. Tell them. And that tells you that even when you're dealing with other people, you have to be very careful how you handle them and how you treat them. Because it's the same way you will feel bad, it's the same way that a person will feel bad if something bad is done. So we could also help children learn empathy by encouraging secure attachments, you know, making sure that children have quality attachments. You know, they don't grow up feeling like there's no much permanence. Today we have this caregiver, tomorrow we have another one. At school today we have this teacher. Before we even settle down, getting to know them, we have another teacher. So that security makes children, that safety in attachment helps children to develop empathy. And there are so many other ways because there is no particular point in life where you say, now I've developed all the empathy I needed, or I've displayed all the empathy that I needed. Empathy is work in progress, because there are so many situations in life that require us to show empathy. As you're bringing up a child in the day-to-day small activities, responding to them, showing care and showing concern to the feelings of others, and even to the feeling of your own child, modeling the right behavior, ensuring that your children are securely attached. All these are just simple ways which can be used in everyday living to help your child develop. I mean, to help a child grow empathy. So as we walk the journey of nurturing our children, we need to realize that we are presented with so many opportunities in life that we can develop, that we can help our children learn more. Of course, most like any other skill in life, the earlier we start to develop, right? But it's never too late for anything in a child's life. So wherever you are, whatever stage your child is in development, look for opportunity, depending again on their developmental stage. For older children, you can take them out, you can ask them to put together the clothes that are stuck in their closet that they don't need anymore. And you could help identify needy children or needy people who could benefit from those clothes or those items, take them. And as they are picking them up, make sure they don't pick tall things or things in bad shape. Because you're trying to tell them, when we are extending, when we are displaying empathy, when we are showing, empathy and sympathy are two different things. They are not, you know, when you are sympathizing, anything could do. But empathy is something different. We want them to know that I don't need it because, you know, it is the worst, it's what I hate most. No. You help them sort whatever they need to give out and go with them. You know, a lot of times we think of our children's closet and we take. No, go with them, let them see, let them, it's not torture, it's not adversity. They're getting to know that there are a few people who may not be in the same place in life like we are. People also even do a grocery shopping and visit a neighbor or someone who could be needy, surprise them. Or if their grandparents send for foodstuff from the village, sometimes we are sent for things, we send for farm produce and we keep it in the house and your children are watching it and it grows in the pantry. So what are you doing to them? Telling them we hold everything to ourselves. So let them see you sharing out, saying, this mango, Spanish mission mango, considering where it comes from. So these mangoes, we put them in this tray, we take them to our neighbor next door, these bananas, share them. But you know, as you're doing that, that's an opportunity right there for your child to run, to learn how to empathize. And maybe people who do not come from locations where such problems could be sent over to them. As we finish our today's episode, I'm going to use the words of Mary Gordon, the founder of Roots of Empathy. She says that empathy is not taught, empathy is taught. So parents, caregivers, teachers, and anyone in the child's, in children's space, provide opportunities where you can help learners, help children catch empathy. Because as Mary says, mostly empathy is not taught, but rather taught. Thank you.